that, I guess that would make sense to us. The God of the Amen. What does Amen mean?
So be it.
So be it.
I agree.
Yes. It's agreement. It's affirming whatever statement is made. Notice we have the great Amen at the end of the Eucharistic prayer. Why is it called the great Amen?
Affirming what we just experienced.
Yeah, and it's an Amen to the entire thing. So, yeah. So the great Amen, okay? Start again. Well, with the words.
To the angel of the church in Laodicea write this. The Amen, the faithful and true witness, the source of God's creation, say this.
Okay. And the word witness is in Greek. You remember what I told you? Martyr. The word martyr is Greek for witness. So, the faithful and true witness say martyr. Well, that works. In two ways for us, because it's describing Jesus. Yeah.
I think also that's very insightful, because sometimes we'll hear either in the scripture or especially we've heard about the early church and people who were martyrs. And for me anyway, sometimes it's hard to relate to that, because that's great. I mean, that's important that they did that and they did huge sacrifices, but how does that affect me in this day and age? And if I don't martyr myself in the physical sense, is my journey significant or as significant? But if it's being a witness, then that's a whole different reframe on that.
Exactly. And that's the reason I try to remind people that the word martyr means witness. And why would that be used for those who died for their faith? How much more can you witness then? So by the way, you see then how that comes to me, one who gives his life for it. Don't forget the question one of my former students asked me one day. She said, "Is I give my life to, or I give my life for, is there a difference?" And I said, "Well, if you give your life to God, are you not giving your life for God at the same time? How else do you show that you have given your life to God?" I thought that was an interesting question. What's the difference in the two? Well, they fit together as one, supplementing each other, shall I say. And notice in this translation, it's the beginning of God's creation, and yours has
the source.
The source, and it means the same, of course. And you remember a gospel that conveys that? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And notice, not anything that was made apart from the Word. So, I've told you that mostly the references are to what we call the Old Testament, but you have some allusions to gospel and Pauline material. And songs, so of course. Oh, and I'm about to get to things. I'll pause there for a minute, because then we'll start into what the Spirit says to the churches. I told you that the word horn means power, and I told you that in all of the medieval and Renaissance, and even into the 18th century, you have Moses shown with horns. Well, here is a it's a lithograph, let me see.
Is that the Bible today?
And it's a Dutch artist, and 1500 to 1553, so 16th century, and you see it with horns.
Mm-hmm. Is that the magazine, the Bible today?
Yes. Another picture, a statue here, and if you don't know that it's horns, it looks like a curl. But remember, they're sheep horn. So I'll pass that around so you can look at it. Sometimes, in some of them, you'll see a ray of light coming, and the horns are showing then in the midst of the ray of light from above. And remember, we talked about the horn of salvation. You've heard that. That's the power of salvation. We lose it, don't we? Because that doesn't mean power to us anymore. Okay.
I have a note in my Bible that says the Amen is a divine title applied to Christ. I never heard that.
Yes. Notice the words of the God of Amen.
Yeah, I just
didn't
know that.
Yeah. That's it. That's the reason I passed along, because I don't think I remember. Knowing that before I was working on this material again.
Did you talk about the whole Moses with horns thing last time? Is that why you brought
yes.
it? Does where besides power, did it come from the fact that there some traditionally he was seen as the author of the Old Testament, or was it due to something else?
Simply because I'd say perhaps more in the New Testament, because Jesus is the new Moses. You'll see him. Well, for example, how many books of Moses are there? Five. Do you know how many divisions are within the Gospel according to Matthew? Five. And where does the sermon come from in Matthew? From Jesus, but where is Jesus? On the mount. Where did the Ten Commandments come from? On the mount. And so just detail after detail presents Jesus as the new Moses. And so that brings into Christianity this great power.
And Jesus, in some ways, isn't he also referred to as the new Adam?
Yes.
So those, in some ways, are very different views, aren't they, in some ways, in terms of Adam wasn't about power?
Well, that's true. That's not indicating power in that sense. It's what you have in Jesus, and again, I don't think we think about this too much. Jesus is the summation of everything and everybody. And so, he's the new Adam. He's the new Noah. How is he the new Noah? did Noah?
The covenant with God.
Covenant, what kind of a covenant? Covenant of?
Peace.
Peace. And what does Jesus say again and again and again? Peace be with you. How shall I say this? One of the things that scholars indicate is that they talk about Jesus, the recapitulation of the tradition. Okay? Recapitulation means re-experience it, re-going through it. Okay? Who came out of Egypt? The people, right? Okay.
And so did Jesus.
I mean, it's all over the place. The more you know about Old Testament and Old Testament traditions, you see that Jesus embodies all of them. And so it's not just the aspect of power comes Moses. The aspect of the beginning. And by the way, what does the word Adam mean? Mankind or humankind? Well, of course Jesus is the second humankind. Am I responding here?
Yeah, and when the talk about Moses and power, was that ultimately the power of leading the folks out of Egypt, out of slavery, or is it power in a lot of different ways?
Power in a lot of different ways.
Okay.
Yeah. My usual statement as a Catholic, yes. And by the way, as I've said so many times, I love that about our faith. It's not simplistic. It's simple. And again, I'm sorry leaving this so much, but the word simple during the Christian era, and that goes to sometime in mid-1700s, it's called the Christian era, and during that time, many words have very different meanings from now. To us, simple means pare down and simplify. Am I correct? Christian era, simple did not mean simplifying the way we, but actually, it's sort of like seeing from the perspective of God. Okay, that's connected to this, this to that, that to that. Everything's connected, and you can see how they're connected. That's simple. Perceiving all the connections means, that's simple. Almost exactly opposite. Well, you know what the word leave and let, especially let, you'll find it in the King James Version, you'll find it in the Douay Rheims. Let meant prevent. Every let and hindrance, to us it means allow. And that change in language came during the 18th century because there was that tremendous change in the way we see the world, God, ourselves. It's called a shift or change in the worldview. And that does not mean by the individual, it means just by the Western world, because that's what we're talking about. Okay, I chased enough rabbits. All right.
Let's begin then.
Oh, we shall. Mary, 14, please.
To the angel of the church in Laodicea, write this. Amen, the faithful and true witness, the source of God's creation, say this. I know your works. I know that you are neither hot nor cold, cold nor hot. I wish you were either cold or hot. So So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth.
Okay. Notice this is the most forceful negative statement we've seen. Remember, this is not to individuals. And boy, I heard this used for individuals again and again and again. Remember who the church is?
Us.
People come. Father Jim's homily Sunday made it very clear, I think. For those of you, St. Thomas, he began by saying, you know that I was a teacher for many years. Well, today you're having a pop quiz. And the question is, who's the church? Who or what, I think you said, is the church.
Okay.
So, yeah, this is to the people of God at Laodicea. Okay, keep reading. 17.
For you say, I am rich and affluent and have no need of anything, and yet you do not realize that you are wretched. You are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked.
You know, that to me is a very disturbing statement. Now, people have in mind, we as a church are rich. Many of us want for nothing. I wonder, and of course I'm not wishing for poverty and hardship on any of us, but I wonder if we are so comfortable here. There's no eagerness at all to see God. What do we typically say? Someone who says, well, I'm not feeling great today. I have a pain here. I have a pain here. You know what I mean? Some of you more than others. And then you'll hear people say, well, better than
the alternative.
Better than the alternative for us. Follow Christ? How can you say that? Am I making sense? And I remember my mother's statement. She picked it up somewhere. She says, I know that heaven is my home, but I'm not homesick yet.
I know this is just a generalization, maybe a stereotype, but one of the things that strikes me, because I know no matter where we are, there are people that are happy and sad and going through all kinds of life's emotions. But when in movies or in life, when you see sort of documentaries, one of the things that strikes me when you go to places, some places of poverty, especially in Africa and other countries, it seems like when folks are there to try to help, there's a significant part of at least what you see, that there are people that are so thankful. And they're smiling, the kids are running around, all they want to do is, you know, be with, not necessarily get anything from, but just be with these people that are there helping out, and that their spirit just seems so energized. And sometimes when I'm going through a tough time, I look at that and go, you know, where does that come from? How can they be so happy and so just filled with life when they go home and they don't, you know, they don't. Intellectually, I know that things don't bring you happiness. But I wonder, like you say, if we were to leave here and go to, you know, a thatched hut and no bathroom, no inside bathroom, and we didn't know if we were going to have anything to eat. You know, for some of us, that might bring us closer to God. For other of us, it might not.
Yeah. In fact, I know of people who, when something tragic happened, left God. I would say, how could God do that to me when I've been, you know, faithful, whatever.
I was thinking when you were commenting about that. Growing up, I grew up without electricity until I was probably sixth grade, and running water and whatever. Well, you never thought nothing of it. We grew up on a farm. And it was just, it is what it is, kind of like, and it wasn't that we were poor, or we didn't feel poor, we didn't feel rich, we just, it was just the way things were. But now, it seems like nowadays, the measure is a little different, you know, like, you measure things differently than like the olden days, I suppose. But this was the United States in Northeast Iowa. We were content and happy, and what's the problem, yeah?
Well, I can't say that in my family we were happy, we weren't. And it wasn't because of what we didn't have, whether we had or didn't have. People in my family would not have been happy. Always great conflict. And unfortunately, still is among some members of my family. Shall I say, nobody was an outlaw, but goodness, I met plenty of in-laws.
But you were a family.
Well, yes and no. An in-law was never good enough.
Oh.
I'm serious. There was always conflict.
And that was in everybody's family, that wasn't just in yours?
No, I don't mean, I mean it was definitely in my family. Whether it was in other families, I don't know.
Okay.
And as I say, it wasn't because of what we had or didn't have. But there is one person who was very, very important to me when I was a child. She was always happy. She was the 70, well, let's see, her husband was 70 years old. She was a few years younger, maybe 67, 68. They moved, they were tenant farmers. They moved to my grandparents' place when he was 70, and she was, as I say, a few years younger, maybe 67, 68. They were the kindest, most giving people. They had nothing. They lived in a house that was not even sealed. It was just, what do you call it, clapboard? Clapboard with a tin roof, rough wood floors with cracks in them, you know, because they were put on there when the wood was green. There was a shed room that, so far as I could see, they hardly ever used. It had stuff in it. But they were the kindest, most giving people, and she was. I wasn't around him that much because he was in the fields all the time. He worked all the time in the field. This kind of a plow with a mule. I mean, he worked hard, so no wonder I never saw him. But she taught us all kinds of things. She was happy, and they had nothing. I know I'm chasing a rabbit, but I think this is very important because this deals with exactly what we see here. My dad was always trying to pull pranks on people. He was a prankster. And he came to my grandparents. We were all with my grandparents. And he had big black rimmed glasses with a great big nose on it. I don't know what he said. He borrowed my uncle's hat, which was all not very good shape, put it on, and my uncle's blazer, which was old, so it didn't look too good. And he went around to the neighbors saying, I've been on the road all day, and I need a place to stay. Could you put me up for the night, that kind of thing? Well, his cousin's husband opened the door. I'm sorry, we don't have an extra bed. He had two extra beds. And my dad said, and he was reading his Bible. Went to his great aunt's, and she was like some of us, didn't hear as well as she used to do. She talked louder than she knew. And she came to the door and she went back and she says, her husband's name was John. She says, John, stay in the bed. This is the awfulest looking man I've ever seen. Okay, I could keep going, but you got the picture? Last of all, he went to the Woodsons. And when Mr. Woodson was surprised, he would rock. And so he came to the door and he rocked a bit. And my dad went through this spiel. He said, well, my wife's kind of, she's not too good right now, but and we don't have much, but come on in, you can have share what we have. It wasn't funny. The only person of that whole area where he met would let him in. I think your point is well made. This is what concerns me about myself and us.
Right, I want to say that I come from a third world country, but it's a lot of people that live, and if you open the door, they attack you. And so people don't open the door, even if the people, because you don't know, some of them dress as people that really poor, they need something, and you open your door and you get killed.
But
so
that was not, yeah.
I tell you because it happened to me. I was 10 years old, my family was at home, and this man said and opened the door. The next thing, he put a knife on my face and robbed the whole house in 3 minutes.
But that
so,
wasn't true in Mississippi, is my point. See.
But what I'm trying to say, it's depending where you be.
That is correct. That is correct. But nothing like that had ever happened that we knew of. So.
But
yeah.
You had a bunch of people, a group of people that were experiencing the same thing, and they responded differently.
Exactly. And this was the reason I said to you, she was in the She's the only person I ever said, we need to pray for so-and-so. Now this woman who, by this time they lived there several years, I mean she was over 70. Down on her knees she went on those rough wooden boards and she says, well then let's pray. So she and I prayed right there.
Yeah, what spurred your father to do that?
He had a strange sense of humor.
Yeah, you know, why would he have to, what reasoning did he have for doing that, you know?
He got what he thought he might get, and then he would say, oh my, to my cousin and say, my, oh, you got a lot out of your Bible, didn't you? I mean, he was like that.
What'd your mother say?
Well, my mother, did not like any of this at all. And by the way, you know that my father himself is Irish. And every time he told a story, like the kind of thing I do, every time you tell a story, it's supposed to get better. And my mother said to me, Pop said, your father lies.
It's in Irish.
So Mary, you know, why did my grandfather?
I wonder why he even did that experiment.
It wasn't an experiment, it was a prank. I mean, he did it.
Did he think he was being funny?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He thought he was being funny.
He's Irish. Irish.
I have reason to do it.
Oh, well, shall we come back to this? But read again, will you, verse, starting 15.
I know your works. I know that you are neither hot, cold nor hot. I wish you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. For you say, I am rich and affluent and have no need of anything. And yet you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. I advise you to buy from me gold refined by fire.
Okay, now that's an allusion to one of St. Paul's letters. He refers to the fire of God burning works, and the works being tried like gold in the furnace. Go ahead.
I advise you to buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich, and white garments to put on, so that your shameful nakedness may not be exposed.
Remember what the white garment? The white robe, white garment. White is an indication of
victory.
It may have the connotation of purity, but victory here. And traditionally, white was associated with victory. Queen Victoria gave it the connotation of purity. And so, yeah.
It would be like a victory that you free yourself from all sin.
It's the kind of thing. Jesus conquered death and Hades and Satan and so on and so on, and that's victory in that sense. Yes, victory over sin.
Yes. Exactly. Think of baptism and how they have the white garment.
White garment at baptism. That's the reason those of us who are on the altar wear a white alb. And so that's, I hope we're not being hypocritical in doing so.
Would you explain verse 15 when he says that he's going to vomit us out if we're lukewarm?
Ah, thank you. Okay. It's the kind of thing, I was telling you about my family, all right? Nobody in my family would have said anything bad about church, about Jesus. I mean, we went to the Baptist church, and we sang as loud as anybody, and went to Sunday school and so on. But there was never any sense in any of us that I know of, and notice I said that I know of, that you brought any of that home and it affected your lives. And please know that I am not judging them. I'm saying that I know of. And I'm basically talking about myself growing up.
When it's interesting to me that the writer doesn't just say, I wish that you would either be that you would be passionate for Christ, but you're lukewarm. He says hot or cold versus being lukewarm is being lukewarm is in some ways here worse than being hot or cold. So does that have to do with the fact that you're trying to communicate that I wish you were, you know, passionate in either
some
being
sense
for or against, but you're just sort of there in the middle, not really caring either way.
You're not a passionate person will go to extremes, right?
Right.
And a person at extremes often will go to the other extreme when there's a change. Okay? That's the idea. That being, you know, well, have you ever heard agnostics are cowards? An agnostic says, I don't know whether it's a God or not. Okay? I've heard agnostics are cowards. They won't commit to anything. It's something.
Versus the atheist and the strong.
Yeah.
So.
I've only heard that agnostics dress up in a casket means that they're all dressed up with no place to go.
That's what you went to me.
I also thought about, not of any particular party, but I thought about sometimes, I think it's the American people look at our politicians, and we, in some ways, we wish that they were either really for this or really for that, but when they're sort of like, I'll say whatever I think needs to be said in order for me to move forward with my political career, and then they'll change it if the political climate is different, either side. There's that sense of we're attracted to somebody, even if we may or may not vote to them, we at least say, well, man, they really believe what they believe.
Yeah, and, interesting, reminding me of something a professor said once. He had been in the military and had worked with a psychiatrist, a military psychiatrist, and he said, one young soldier came in and said, I don't know who I am. When I'm with this group, I'm that way. When I'm with this or that group, I'm a totally different way. He said, I'm with whoever I talk to. Which one of those am I? And he said, the psychiatrist said, which one do you want to be? Which one do you want to be? I think we've all experienced something of being different people with different groups. And I've often thought of that. Which one do you want to be? And I see that many, many times when people say, I want to change. And my comment is this. You have to want to change more than you don't want to change. They're almost always both involved. So, yeah, look warm. Okay, go ahead, Amy. Start again with 18.
I advise you to buy from me gold refined by fire so that you may be rich, and white garments to put on so that your shameful nakedness may not be exposed. Buy ointment to smear on your eyes so that you may see.
Okay, does that ring a bell? Notice the an allusion to the gospel, but nothing that you find in this book is obviously New Testament. And by that I mean there is no reference to Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, any of those. Now there will be, it's kind of like gold, tried by fire, okay, that's used, but that could be used in other ways. This is a book that draws from Jewish tradition, which Romans would not know. It's a subversive book, and thus it's a book of code. It's written in code. Am I making sense? The Old Testament, Jewish tradition, who would know besides Jews? And of course, what were the early Christians reading? They didn't have a New Testament. It hadn't been written. Or they were in the process of writing it. So by drawing on the symbolic and hyperbole and so on from the Old Testament, Christians could understand it, but the people around them would say, this is crazy stuff. And isn't that what some of us say nowadays? Yeah. Okay, Mary 19.
Those whom I love, I reprove and chastise. Be earnest, therefore, and repent.
Okay, this is that. Could be an allusion to the book. Let me take you to the Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 12. A few books.
Chapter what?
12. Hebrews 12 is just a few books back
consider how he endured such opposition from sinners in order that you may not grow weary and lose heart.
Okay. Lose heart, faint-hearted, slow of heart. That's very close to the point, by the way. Go ahead, please.
In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood. You have also forgotten the exhortation addressed to you as sons. My son, do not disdain the discipline of the Lord, or lose heart when reproved by him. For whom the Lord loves, he disciplines. He scourges every son he acknowledges. Endure your trials as discipline. God treats you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline?
Okay, thank you, Mary. That, you see there's a quotation there? That's a quotation from the book of Proverbs. So, notice, is this quoted that? No, but that's certainly a reminder of that.
Kind of took me by surprise. There's a note in my Bible that says that Laodicea, is that how you pronounce it?
I'm sorry?
Laodicea? Is that how you pronounce it?
Laodicea.
Laodicea, okay. That it's 40 miles southeast of Philadelphia.
Yes.
In the United States?
No.
No.
Philadelphia is one of the cities there. By the way, just as a reminder, these seven churches, and seven is the number for what?
Perfection.
Completeness, wholeness, that which is completed. And so he has seven churches, and they are, if you connect the dots from city to city, it's an oval. And so reminds people, reminds several of the commentators, of a circle, because a circle was also used for completeness. No beginning and no end. Okay, go ahead, Mary. Starting with 19.
Those whom I love, I reprove and chastise. Be earnest, therefore, repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, then I will enter his house and dine with them and be with me.
Okay. Now, again, remember, who is this addressed to?
Church.
A
church at Laodicea. Okay. Have you not seen the picture of Jesus knocking on the, there's no handle? Yeah. No door knob, nothing. Okay. Notice, that's a Protestant. Because the idea is this refers to individuals, not to the church. This is the kind of thing I've mentioned to you before, and please understand, I'm not criticizing Protestants or Protestants when I say this kind of thing, because as I've told you many, many times, I'm grateful for my Baptist background. But I am aware, I became aware of what I would call use of the scripture that didn't quite square with what's there. And this is one of the examples of that. Because who ever thought of this is referring to a church? Nobody. So, behold, I know. Be aware of, I'm going to take it to chapter 4 real quickly, the next chapter. Mary, I want you to read just verse 1 of chapter 4, and not even all of it.
After this, I had a vision of an open door to heaven.
I had a vision of an open door. And notice, the door to heaven is open. The door on earth in this church is closed. You see why I went from the one to the other. Heaven is always open, but for the weak ones, I was open. Church of God denomination, not Assembly of God. They're very, very different. The Church of God denomination owned the house just south of us. And we, I think we were usually and about the only friends that the pastors, series of pastors had, because I thought they were good neighbors and lovely people. And they kept saying, this little group doesn't want anybody else coming into the church. They're just a little clique. Now the pastor said this, I did not. And so finally, the last pastor who was there said, every pastor that I know of who's been here has said, there's no way this church can grow because it's exclusive. So the denomination closed that church and sold it, and it's now a dwelling. The denomination closed the church because they said it was closed already. I think that reminds us here, okay, notice, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Let's make sure our church is open.
I was thinking about that and how you're talking about how a Protestant view might make that personal or emphasize the personal. But I also was thinking about, and maybe you addressed this last time, is, okay, so this was written to a church. So back in the day, if this was literally something that was written to a church, would there have been a church leader that would have then read this to the people of the church?
Yes. In fact, good time to remind you all of something. Chapter 1, chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed is he who reads aloud the words of the prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and keep what is written therein, for the time is near.
So I guess where I'm going with that is that although this was written to a church, if it then was read in front of the church, in some ways, to me, from a layman's perspective, it seems like it would be somewhat like a homily. And especially if the homily was, the archbishop has this message, and I've been to at least a couple where that happens. The archbishop says it's important that we all be aware of this, so I'm going to read this, or I'm going to share with you the message. At that point, when it becomes a message and a homily or some sort of presentation, then isn't it a challenge for each of us to hear that and
Absolutely. Say,
knocking on the door, okay, it might technically be the church when it was written, but now that the pastor is saying it and I'm hearing it, there is a personal component, isn't it, where Jesus is knocking on the door of my heart and I need to, you know, be open versus saying I've got it all figured out and I don't need that?
The difference is this. You could say, yes, in a sense, but in another sense, there are individuals within this church, and that's we're going to see that, who do have their hearts opened. So it's the church as a whole that's being addressed, rather than the individual in that sense. Remember, everything that was written in this day was read aloud. Nothing was written to be read silently. Most people, you couldn't write unless you were specially trained. So the chances are Paul did not write any of his letters, but dictated them. Because look at Hebrew and Greek. It's like calligraphy. So you really have to be trained to write. So yes, everything would be read aloud, and I've always loved one statement about St. Ambrose. Ambrose lived from 320 to, 340 to 380 something. And he is the first person on record to have silent reader. That's 300 years into the Christian era. And the reason we get that, those who wrote about it said, one person said, it's really strange. His mouth moves, but no sound comes out. So you see what I mean? It was very late that you have.
Well, right in this point, 3:22 says, let him who has ears heed the Spirit's word to the church.
Exactly.
So there's the word right there.
That's right. Okay. But pick up again, let's finish this one. 20 again.
Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, then I will enter his house and dine with him, and he with me.
And that's, of course, a lot of companion. Go ahead.
I will give the victor the right to sit with me on my throne.
Okay, so he'll give the victor what right? And by the way, victor with white robe on room. If he's going to sit with Jesus on the throne, what's he going to be?
Royalty.
Yeah, king. And how shall I say this? The song that I have seen quoted by New Testament writers and even non-New Testament writers in the early church, perhaps more than any other, is the beginning of Psalm 109 or Psalm 110, depending on your translation. So would you turn to there? In mine, it's Psalm 110, and others it's Psalm 109. It begins, the Lord says to my Lord. Karen, you got it? Please read.
The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. The center of your power, the Lord will stretch forth beside
you. Okay, now, and Judaism just has one meaning, but in Christianity, it is understood as God the Father and God the Son. And so, remember what two apostles asked for?
Sit at the right.
One sit on the right, the other on the left, and Jesus said, it's not mine to give. Okay. So you see the idea that permeates the New Testament of being a king. Well, remember, we are baptized as prophets, priests, and kings. And so the idea of our being kings permeates the New Testament. And so here, sit on the throne. Start with 21 and read.
That's Revelation.
Yes.
Thank you. <Yeah. laughs> I would give the victor the right to sit with me on my throne, as I myself first won the victory, and sit with my Father on his throne. Whoever has ears ought to hear what the Spirit says to the churches.
Okay. And again, this is what Dale was talking about here. Okay. This is certainly what you have individuals within the church, and so some of those are okay, but it's the church as a whole that is writing to. Now, any question before I start trying to pull all this together?
Just one quick one. When it talks about I will enter his house and dine with him, my understanding is back in the day, early, Christ had died and the followers were starting to meet, that there really weren't formalized churches. It was they were meeting in their homes.
That's correct.
And I don't know when the Eucharist was, there was a Last Supper, but I'm not sure when the Eucharist being shared with amongst others was instituted. But could that have a reference to people going into the home and actually sharing bread and wine? And
first of all, I would say it has the connotation of a guest.
That reminds me of that on the gospel reading about the road to Emmaus, because the disciples knew it was Jesus in the breaking of the bread.
Exactly.
They went in and had a meal with him.
So, first of all, and by the way, in that story, notice, they invite him to stay, but he acts as host.
Yes.
Yeah. Can I say he acts as host with a host?
Right.
Okay, first of all, hospitality. And notice, hospitality was I guess I'd say an unbreakable law in our tradition.
Well, that's the story in Leviticus.
Yes. So absolutely. You're welcome to stranger. So that first of all. Then I will come in and dine with him. Whom do you dine with?
Your friends.
Family and friends. Okay, so that's the second element of it. And then, of course, and by the way, just as a reminder, I'm going to read something really quickly. I'm sorry, it's not exactly where I thought it was, or I can't see it. It could be the one. But the apostles continued to go where? Do you know? To the temple. They continued to go to the temple and continued with the prayers, and that's the temple prayers, and from house to house they broke bread. So, that apparently begins immediately after Jesus' ascension.
But they weren't breaking bread within the temple, right? It was in the houses?
And from house to house.
Right.
And
would that have been the first forms of what we consider now the Holy Sacrament of Communion?
Yes. The breaking of the bread, notice the one Dale referred to, we recognized him in the breaking of the bread. So that comes obviously very early. And there were no churches as such built until the 4th century. Do you know why? Because Christianity was illegal. Okay, remember in this material we've been hearing about the synagogue of Satan? Two of the churches, let's see, okay, if you see it in the, call our attention to it, because I'm having a hard time seeing what's in front of my eyes this morning.
Pergamum?
Yes, 13. Yes, that's one, but there's another one too. This is, I know where you dwell, where Satan's throne is, but the synagogue of Satan. Was written sometime between 90 and 100. possibly a little after 100. And notice, Christians are no longer allowed to worship with the Jews. So quick. Now, who now is called Jew or Israel by the church?
The Gentile.
Pardon? Who is God?
Us.
Okay, I'm going to take you to this. I think I can find quickly. The last verses in Galatians 6 chapter, I'm going to read it. But neither circumcision counts for anything nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. Peace and mercy be upon all who walk by this rule, upon the Israel of God. Notice that's Paul calls the Christians now the Israel of God. And so the Jews who are not, you say they're Jews, that they're not Jews, that is Jews who are not followers of Jesus. And they are being thrust out of the synagogue. See, they continue using the same words. The new Christians. See, they refer to themselves as the remnant. Remember the prophets we looked at earlier? The remnant of faithful would survive.
And was this the basis of the argument about whether circumcision had to be
whether it was or not? Yeah, this is a part of the part of the argument about that. You know, okay, if we are the real Jews, then the Gentiles who come in have to be circumcised so that they can be real Jews. You see the idea? So, indeed, that's the idea.
Would you say that not kind of being cast out and so forth, was that mainly because of what you just described, the conflict and the challenge between the real Jews and these new non-Jew, these real Gentiles and so forth? And is it possible too that there was a lot of political pressure from the outside government that said, if we know these are really sort of Christians or they're non-Jews, and the Jews are harboring the non-Jews, and so from a security standpoint, it was easier, or the Jewish folks weren't going to get as much flack from the government if they just said, you can't come here anymore?
I think not, and I'll tell you why I think not. First of all, we read in the New Testament about concern about the Jews being together in a group and rebelling. Paul, in a sense, precipitates some of that. And so the authorities step in because there's and it's exactly that, conflict between the Jews who don't follow Jesus and Jews who do. In 64, a rebellion began of the Jews. And as a result, as a result, the Romans tried to obliterate Jews, period. It was what we would call nowadays
genocide.
Genocide, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's what we would call it. And you know, I had no idea how many thousands of Jews, how many tens of thousands were killed or committed suicide during that time. I mean, it was just, we found that out when we went to Israel and we took it to different places. You remember?
I didn't go to Israel.
Oh, that's right. Rita.
Where's Rita?
Where's Rita?
Rita did.
Yeah. And so, first of all, the rebellion was going on. They destroyed Jerusalem, destroy the temple with it, of course, and rename that area Palestine. The Roman authorities renamed that area Palestine. And then there was another rebellion that was later put down. And as a result, no Jew that existed, and that would mean Christian too, was allowed to live in Palestine. Anybody who acknowledged that faith tradition could not live in Palestine. Now, as long as Christians continued to go to the synagogue, they had no problem, the government had no problem with them, because they were seen as just another Jewish sect. And you know, there were others, but the ones we know most, Pharisees, Sadducees, and Essenes. So there was no problem as long as they continued to go to the synagogue. But once they're separated from the Jews, then they're illegal. You see, they saw themselves as being kicked out of the synagogue, if you will. So, synagogue of Satan.
So what were the Jews rebelling against?
I'm sorry?
What were the Jews rebelling against?
The government. The Roman government.
It sounds like you're saying that the Roman government, until they responded to the rebellion, that they were allowing the Jews to practice, and as long as the Christians...
This was prior to 70. This was.
So they didn't have the right to worship before 64 without the government?
They did have the right. Jews had the... All religions within the Roman Empire were declared legal by Caesar, but two provisos. You couldn't change your religion, and you couldn't create a new religion. And so as long as the Christians were thought of as part of the, basically just more Jews, no problem.
John, what were some of the names of the religions?
I'm sorry?
What were some of the names of the religions?
Oh, goodness. That's it. There were many. First of all, the Roman pantheon. That would have been Jupiter, Juno, Mars, Venus, worship of them. There was also the cult of emperor cult. There were, in many of the cities, they had their individual gods. God from city to city.
Egypt was Isis. Pardon? Was Egypt Isis?
Egypt had Isis as a goddess, yes. And so, but there were religions by the tons all over the place. One of the major differences in the Jews and non-Jews was that when you went to a different place, you had a different god. Because it was the god of the place, not the god of the people. Jews carried their gods with them. And we know that was not always true, because we see what's happening when they go into the promised land. Some of the people began to worship the gods of that land. So, Am I responding to the question?
I think so, but I'm still not clear what the Jews were rebelling against if they were allowed.
Against the invasion.
If they were allowed to worship.
The Roman. So it's like, doesn't matter your religion, they were against the government, the Roman. They wanted to be free. But that was the whole thing.
Well, you see, the Jews were conquered during the Maccabean rebellion, finally. The Jews were conquered. But they were not conquered then. They had a kingdom until, well, Herod was theoretically part of the king, but he was a puppet of the Roman government.
Okay, so I think what I'm getting mixed up on is that they were allowed to worship, but as long as they stayed in their little bubble, they were fine. But if they wanted more than to just be, you know, sort of have their thumb on them, kind of like America and the British, that as long as we played our little role and we were good little, you know, people, then we were fine. But if we wanted something more than that, and we wanted to stand up to the government, to the British government, there was going to be violence. And is that where the rebellions came from?
Like to have a dictator. The dictator, even as a puppet, has its own power. But if you live in there, you cannot do anything. You have to do what the dictator said. And that's where they're Roman.
And Roman is in charge.
It's in charge of everything.
And I think what I'm missing is
so
when I think of...
the rebel, like we will rebel against the invasion.
And my shortcoming is that when I hear Jewish, I think purely religion and practice and so forth. That's just one element of what it means to be Jewish.
And that was not the issue at all with any of this. This was strictly and purely political. And there was even a party that is referred to the Zealots. That was political, not religious.
And they were formed to try to get out from under the Romans.
They were what we would call terrorists.
Right.
And it's interesting that our connotation of zealot is a lot sometimes pejorative. You know, we just think a zealot is, at least I do, I might not know what the word actually means, but when I've heard it in the past, somebody says, oh, don't mind him, he's just a zealot. That might be a misuse of,
well, it's like Marvin. The language has changed.
Yeah.
But, yeah, once Christianity was seen as different by the Jews themselves, you see. I'm not talking about political now, because the persecution of Christians was first of all by Jews, fellow Jews, because they were violating. Remember, they ate with unwashed hands?
That was a no-no.
That was an absolute no-no. And remember, this had nothing to do with hygiene. It had to do with ritual worship. Cleansing. Remember, they ate something on the seventh day?
Yeah.
They changed the seventh day to Sunday. That's right. They worshiped on Sunday. However, they continued, even though for a while they went to the temple or the synagogue on the Sabbath, and then, notice, on the Christian Sabbath, they broke bread. And you have in 1 Corinthians an early reference to that kind of thing, how they are misusing that and showing the prejudice within the church itself, among the Christians. Okay. we got about 4 minutes, and so I'm going to tell you what we're going to start with next week. Somebody, and I can't remember who, asked me to pull all this material together so we can see it as a whole. And so I'm going to ask you, okay, what are the things in common here, and what are the differences? So we're going to do it, shall I say, I'm going to attempt a rather quick overview. And by the way, that's the reason I brought in the board today.
We didn't get there.
We didn't get there. And that's okay with me. So we'll begin there. Then we'll go to heaven. In fact, as I said, I'm going to ask you what you see as common elements. So, it's an announced pop quiz. Okay. Fred, good to have you today. Let's get you on the list. Jim is not here today, so we'll get you on the list next week. Oh, okay. You're on the list. Okay, shall we pray? The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Gracious Lord, we give you thanks for the opportunity of freedom. And we thank you for the abundance that you've given us. But Father, we pray that we may recognize that having too much can come between us and our worship and love. Pray that we may be rich in the spirit, not paupers in the spirit. Bless us that we may grow in faith and love and in service to you, our Father. Christ our Lord. Amen. Lois asked about a commentary of something that would be helpful in Bible study. And she said, what in the world bless you? Okay, this is excellent. It's called The Bible Today, and it's published by the Liturgical Press, St. John's Abbey Liturgical Press. Yes, it's the Bible. Oh, sure. I love this thing. You'll actually find some things related to our tradition and the pictures, and it's just some it does some interesting things that take you beyond the text itself sometimes.
And then has the birthday and Virgin to the back that gives the Old Testament reviews of Old Testament books, and Donald Senior reviews the New Testament books.
That's right. And that could be a great resource because it tells you books that you could purchase. But as I say, there's so many things here. That's not Moses, right? There are two ways you could tell it's not Moses.
No horns.
No horns and a halo.
Oh.
The halo is used for the saints. St. Andrew, but I'll have to check.
Oh.
It's right there in front of me. St. Andrew.
They don't go to the angels.
Pardon?
They don't compare to the angels.